गुड मॉर्निंग लर्नर्स, लर्नर्स ऑफ एमसीओ फोर्थ सेमिस्टर, एंड टुडेज टॉपिक इज अबाउट डिमांड एनालिसिस. इन द प्रीवियस क्लास यू हैव स्टडीड अबाउट इंट्रोडक्शन टू मैनेजरियल इकोनॉमिक्स. दिस इज द ब्लॉक टू ऑफ एमसीओ 12, एंड दिस इज अबाउट डिमांड एनालिसिस. इट्स अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक. इट्स अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक. Demand, by demand, what we mean? We mean desire for a commodity. Okay. So, but in economics, demand has a slightly different definition. So, demand is an economic principle referring to a consumer's desire to purchase goods and services and willing to pay a particular price for a specific goods or services. Okay, so in this block we'll be covering the demand, the topic, the demand, and relation between price and quantity demanded. What is elasticity of demand? What are the factors of forecasting demand? About demand estimation. Okay, so for today's class, our resource person is Dr. Vinod Sarangi sir, and retired associate professor, Bargad Panchayat College. So he will be delivering a lecture in this topic. So may I request Dr. Vinod Sarangi sir to start the session. Thank you, sir.
So good morning. So this second block is your demand and revenue analysis. First, so unit four, as per your managerial economics. That is demand concept and analysis. That's the first topic that we'll take up. So what is demand? Demand means desire for a thing. It may be a commodity, it may be a service. But in economic parlance, we define demand in a comprehensive way. So in economic parlance, the demand means desire for a commodity. This is the first one. Second, ability to purchase, and willing, third is willingness to spend. So if these three things are present, then we call it as demand in economics. Suppose I have a desire for a Maruti car and I have the willingness to purchase it, but I don't have the money, I don't have the ability. So I can't call it as demand in economics. So demand means desire for a commodity, backed by ability to pay and willingness to purchase it. So next is, what is a demand function? So demand functions is a relationship between demand and the other determinants or the factors that influence demand. So what are the other factors that influence demand? That we call it as demand functions. The first and foremost important factor is price. That is price of the commodity that we want to purchase. Suppose you want to purchase the commodity called potato. So the price of the potato is the foremost important thing. The second thing that is known as demand for, that is substitute of the commodity. Substitute means that another commodity you take in exchange of this first one. So commodity tea and coffee, they are substitute. So commodity X and Y, if X is not available, if we can go for the Y, then we call it a substitute. So next that influence demand is your complementary goods. Complementary goods means those goods are demanded jointly, like petrol and car, bus and diesel. Like this, they are complementary goods. That is known as joint demand. They demand jointly. And the other most important factor is income. So income of the consumer, because demand is always related to the consumer. Income of the consumer is important thing to influence the demand, because if the income is not there, then there cannot be a demand even if the price is low. Next thing that we go to is test and preferences. We have tests then preferences for the commodity that is concerned. Next thing is rate of interest that also influence these your demand functions. Next is your advertisement also influence this demand functions. So these are the all the variables which are related to demand. We call it as functional relationship or the demand functions. So this demand functions, I will tell you when I will present it in a your PowerPoint. So next comes your demand curve. What is demand curve? So when this demand, we present it in a diagram or a graph, we call it as demand curve. So before going to that, I will tell you what is a demand schedule. So demand schedule means price is in one axis and demand in another axis. It the different price level for quantity demanded varies. Suppose the price is 5, quantity demanded is 50. Price is 10, quantity demanded is 25. Price is 20, quantity demanded is, let us say, 15. So like this, the demand schedule, which I will tell you, show you the schedule in PowerPoint presentation. And if this demand schedule is plotted in a graph or a diagram, we call it as demand curve. So this demand curve is generally a downward sloping curve. That is, it slopes from left to right, or we call this as it is a negative slope. So at in one axis we have quantity demanded, in another axis we have price. The relationship when price and quantity demanded, that is quantity demanded and price, that we call it as demand function, price and quantity demanded. This demand functions, we present it in a graph, we call it as demand curve. That's a particular commodity. Suppose it's a commodity X, then the demand curve is for the commodity X only. So this is a downward sloping curve. This we speak of the individual demand curve. So we have a market demand curve also. What is that market demand curve? Suppose there are three individual X, Y, and Z. At a particular level, the demand different commodities. Suppose when onion price is 20, let us say A demands 10 kg, B demands 15 kg, C demands 20 kg. If we join together, add them, what we get is your market demand. That is 10 plus 15 plus 20, that is 45, that is your market demand. So aggregate of individual demand, we call it as market demand. So the most important thing that we want to study in this law of demand is your demand analysis is the law of demand. So what is this law of demand? So law of demand stated like this. It started with some assumptions, which in economics language we call it a ceteris paribus. That is other things remaining constant. So what are those other things? I will tell you. Other things remaining constant. The relationship between price and quantity demanded is an inverse relationship. So we have a direct relationship and also inverse relationship. What is the inverse relationship? Inverse relations mean the two variables, quantity demanded and price, they behave in opposite direction. That is, if price falls, quantity demanded rises. If price rises, quantity demanded falls. We call this as inverse relationship. Direct relationship is one. If they behave in the same direction, price rises, quantity demanded rises, price falls, quantity demanded falls. So it is an inverse relationship. So that is, what is the ceteris paribus or other things remaining constant? That's what we call it as assumption of the law of demand. But the first assumption is that consumer income is constant or is same. During that period, the consumer income will not change. Second, there is no change in consumer preferences. Suppose I prefer good X. I cannot, during the time period, I cannot change my preference to good Y. I have to remain in good X. So name, no change in prices of related goods. So as I said, that tea and coffee, they are related or substitute goods. There is no change in the prices of these goods. Next, no change is distribution of income. So income distribution, as we say, that there is income inequality in India. So this income inequality, the distribution, no change in distribution. Whatever is there, that is there. So next is no change in government policy. If this, all this assumption holds good, then demand curve slopes downwards from left to right, or it has a negative slope, or when price falls, quantity demanded rises. When price rises, quantity demanded falls. So this is the law of demand. Generally, a demand curve slopes downwards, or the demand curve, the relationship in demand law is inverse relationship. So this is only for normal goods. If the goods are not normal or inferior goods, there may be some exception to the law of demand. So next thing is, what is quantity, change in quantity demanded and change in demand. So again, I repeat, change in quantity demanded and change in demand. So change in quantity demanded means it is unidimensional, that is, it relates to price and quantity demanded in a single demand curve. That is, if price falls, quantity demanded rises. If price rises, quantity, that is contraction, extension of demand. But in case of change in demand, there is shift in the demand curve. If the demand curve remains in one position, if it shifts to some other position, we call it as change in demand or shift in the demand curve. That is, it may be an upward shift or it may be a downward shift. So why this shift may be possible? This is possible because of change in income, change in populations, all this because of this possible. So what I mean to say in the concept of demand is, demand means desire for a commodity backed by ability to pay and willingness to purchase. Demand function is the relationship between demand and other variables which influence demand. And in case of the law of demand, we say that law of demand, the price and quantity, that is particular commodity and particular price, price of X and quantity demanded of X, they are, the law operates with some assumptions. So next I want to say that change in demand, change in quantity demanded. Now I will present them, all this demand concept and this in a PowerPoint. देखा जाऊ ची हेलो
नहीं सर सर सेठी देखो तो गोटे नहीं सर सेठी सर देखो तो गोटे प्रेजेंट नाउ बोली बटन थिबो
नहीं ए जोटा मु पावर पॉइंट ता दउ ची सेटा देखा जाउ
नहीं सर सेठी प्रेजेंट नाउ बोली की गोटे बटन थिबो सेटा प्रेस करला परे आपन स्क्रीन रे जहा शो करिवे सेटा प्रेजेंट हि जिवो
अच्छा अच्छा हो तो
सेठी सर देखो तो गोटे प्रेजेंट नाउ बोली लिखाई थिबो बटन
हां देखो छी
सर बटन माने बॉटम राइट रे तळे राइट साइड रे लिखाई थबो द स्क्रीन रो
तळे राइट साइड रे
हां सर देखा वाला सर
ना दिस सुनो देखो छी
आ
मामा अरे मामा हम टिक गोटे में
सर सर ओके ओके सर नो इशू
हां हम देख
मॉर्निंग सर
मॉर्निंग सर गुड मॉर्निंग
এটা দেখা যাও না কোজন দেখো এবে দেখা লাগি বারিক
নো নো স্যার
নাই
স্যার সেটি তলে প্রেজেন্ট নাও থিব টিকে দেখি দিওন্তু স্যার তলে সে স্ক্রিন স্ক্রিন উপরে টিকে ক্লিক করলে সে তলে গোটে পপ আপ আসিব সেটি রাইট বটম রাইট তলে প্রেজেন্ট নাও পাইলি স্যার হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ সে প্রেজেন্ট নাও কো হ্যাঁ প্রেজেন্ট নাও রে ক্লিক করন্তু হ্যাঁ তারপরে স্যার দেখুন শেয়ার ইওর এন্টায়ার স্ক্রিন লেখা হইতিব হ্যাঁ সেটা শেয়ার ইওর এন্টায়ার স্ক্রিন রে স্ক্রিন উপরে টচ করি কি শেয়ার কর দিওন্তু
এবে দেখালা
यस यस सर यस सर यस सर यस सर देखा गला
हाँ
अगेन
हाँ
सर मिनिमाइज ही जी पावर पॉइंट
मिनिमाइज ही जी अच्छा
Learners, learners, have patience. Your class will be resumed soon. Learners have patience. The resource person will be joining soon. I have already talked to him. So don't leave the session. Okay, sir has joined. Sir has joined. Yes, sir.
का प्रॉब्लम है लगा खिरोद
नहीं सर नहीं पी पीपीटी प्रेजेंटेशन आ गया क्या सर सब ठीक है जी जी ओके ऑल ओके सर
अच्छा
सो लर्नर्स प्लीज डिमांड फंक्शन इज देयर क्वांटिटी डिमांडेड इज अ फंक्शन ऑफ प्राइस That is the original commodity that we want to purchase. P0, I call it as then come the own price of the product, whichever complement goods, substitute goods, income, test and preparation, advertisement, credit, your rate of interest, expectation, then your N stands for number of potential customers and other factors. So this is the demand function, a relationship between quantity demanded and the other variables of demand. So I have told you the demand schedule, that a different price level, quantity units it is written, quantity is demanded. When price is 90, quantity demand is 40. When price is 70, quantity demand 120. When price is 50, quantity demand 200, like this. So it implies when price falls, quantity demanded rises. Price falls, quantity demanded rises. And when price rises from 10, 30, 50, 70, 90, quantity demanded also falls, like this. So this demand schedule is drawn in a diagram. So I have two axes, OX axis and OY axis. My horizontal axis represents quantity demanded of the commodity, the particular commodity that we want to take, and the price of the commodity. If this has plotted in a vertical axis, if I plot this, this become a curve, which is DD curve, which we call it a demand curve, which slopes downwards from left to right, which I have told you that it has a negative slope, or there is an inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. That is, from the axis at OP, quantity demanded is OQ. When price falls to OP1, quantity demanded is OQ1. The reverse way, when price is OP1, quantity is OQ1. If price rises, quantity demanded falls to OQ2, that is by Q1 and Q2. So market demand schedule. So if there are three consumers,
consumer one. Break hoche, speech breaking hoche, Khirod.
Breaking hoche. Bonne kana bhul ho, oshubidha ache. Market demand schedule, there are three consumers, that is three individual or three consumers. So that what I have just discussed, that was your individual demand schedule and individual demand curve. So in the market demand schedule, I have three consumers or individual. Their quantity demanded is Q1, Q2, Q3. At price level 10, the quantity demanded is 2, 0, 0, 2 plus 0 plus 0, 2, like this, 8, 4 plus 1 plus 2, 7, 6, 6 plus 2 plus 4, 12, then 4, 8 plus 3 plus 6, 17, 2, 10 plus 4 plus 8, 22. So same here, when price falls, quantity demanded rises, when price rises, quantity demanded falls. That is the individual demand curve I have shown you. Here there are three demand curves. That is first consumer one, consumer two, consumer three. So if I aggregate them, I get the market demand curve, DM, DM. This is the market demand curve. This is all demand curve. When they are aggregate, we get the market demand curve, which also holds true that at price falls, quantity demanded rises, the price rises, quantity demanded falls. So change in demand and change in quantity demanded. So this is a demand curve, DAD, which is written, this is a demand curve. This demand curve, the price axis and quantity axis, these are in these two axes. If we move from this point to A, quantity demanded is OQ1 at price OP2. OP1, when quantity price falls to OP2, quantity demand rises to OQ2. This is along the same demand curve. This is change in quantity demanded. Change in demand, when the demand curve shift, D1, D1 is the first demand curve, D2, D2 is the second demand curve. When this curve shift to this point, because of change in increase in income or increase in population, we call it a change in demand or increase or decrease in demand. It may also shift downwards if there is a fall in income and fall in cost. population. So next topic that I want to go is your elasticity of demand. So what is this elasticity concept? First I will tell you. So in case of demand lock, whenever we say the elasticity of demand, it generally implies point elasticity or price elasticity of demand. General conclusion is that. So what is the elasticity of demand? So in the first chapter which we study, we say that when price falls, quantity demanded rises, or there is an inverse relationship. So it quantifies that this is the amount that it falls. Now we want to study the magnitude of change in demand to a change in price. So we have three types of commodities. One commodity we call it a luxury commodity. Suppose say air condition is a case of luxury commodity. Comforts commodities, let us say cooler, we call it as a comforts commodities. Then necessities. So commodity can be classified, demand can be classified like this: luxury commodity, comforts commodity, and necessary commodity. So if the price of your AC falls, the quantity demanded of AC will increase, but what amount, but what magnitude? The law of demand is silent on that. If the price of, let us say, salt is a necessity commodity, if the price of salt falls, by what amount or what magnitude the quantity demanded changes? So the general demand law is silent on that. It is elasticity of demand which answer this. What is the change in quantity, what the extent of change in quantity demanded to a change in price. So elasticity in general, this is a concept. If there are two variables, if I say y is a function of x, there's a functional relationship. So y is a dependent variable and x is an independent variable. So value of y depends on the value of x. This is dependent and independent variable. So it implies that Khirod. Hello.
Again, sir.
Second, what a message asila, okay, the question, you cannot show it, will this to the motor.
Nice, sir. Everything is okay, sir. Sir, upon continue. Okay.
So percentage change in dependent variable by percentage change in independent variable, that is what you generally call it as elasticity of demand. So what here we mean to say, that elasticity of demand here means we will study three elasticity of demand. One is price elasticity of demand, another is income elasticity of demand, the third is your cross elasticity of demand. So these things we have to study here. So what is the price elasticity of demand? So generally, elasticity of demand is written as capital E or small e. So both these signs are put under, because this is a absolute figure, this is present in parallel lines, which means that there is no, if it is negative or positive, doesn't matter. So first we come to the price elasticity of demand. Percentage change in quantity demanded of commodity X divided by price of commodity X. Or briefly I say, change in quantity demanded by change in price. So change in quantity demanded, let us say in a particular case, the quantity demanded, which I call it as original price and original quantity, P1. Suppose the at price P1, quantity when it is 20, your quantity demanded is 30. Suppose price is 10, next price is 10, quantity demanded is 40. So what is the change in price and change in quantity demanded? If you divide them, we can find out the elasticity of demand. So this elasticity of demand is generally known as price elasticity of demand. This price elasticity of demand is of mainly of three types. namely elastic demand, unit elastic, and inelastic demand. So elastic demand, when elasticity of demand is greater than 1, that is EP here implies price elasticity of demand, we call it as elastic demand. When this is equal to 1, symbol is somewhat true. So when price elasticity is equal to 1, we call it as unit elastic or unitary elastic. When this is less than 0, we call it as, when it is less than 1, not 0, sorry, when it is less than 1, it is inelastic demand. Again, I repeat, elasticity of demand greater than 1, elastic demand equal to 1, unit elastic demand less than 1, inelastic demand, it is wrong written as 0. So if the elasticity of demand is infinity, we call it as perfectly elastic demand. If it is equal to 0, we call it as perfectly inelastic demand. So this elasticity of demand can be measured with the help of your point method. While coming to the PowerPoint presentations, I will tell you this point method. Here it is not possible to explain because this has to be given, a diagram has to be given. So we have got price and quantity. So a revenue is implies, total revenue implies price multiplied quantity. Marginal revenue is change in quantity, change in total revenue to change in quantity or change in output, which is in differential notation written as dr by dq, and average revenue is total revenue divided by the output. So total revenue is equal to price multiplied by the output. Marginal revenue is the first differentiation of the total revenue, that is change in margin total revenue to a change in output, unit change in output. Average revenue is equal to total revenue divided by output. So what is the relationship between this elasticity of demand and the revenue? When price decreases, in case of elastic demand, that is elastic demand is greater than 1, there will be increase in total revenue. When price decreases, in case of elastic demand, more of the product will be demanded, more than proportionately, so increase in total revenue. So when price increases, there will be a decrease in total revenue. In case of inelastic demand, when the price decrease leads to decrease in total revenue, and increase in price leads to increase in total revenue. So what are the determinants of this price elasticity of demand, or what are the factors that influence price elasticity of demand? So first thing that influences the nature of the commodity. So nature of the commodity, as I have told you, there are three types of commodity: luxury, comforts, and necessaries. For luxury commodity, the demand is generally elastic, and for necessity commodity, the demand is generally inelastic. So next factor, that is availability of substitutes. If the commodity has substitute, then elasticity of demand is more, or it is elastic. Next, the number of uses of the commodity. Take the case of electricity. Electricity has multiple uses. Because it has multiple uses, that is why your demand for electricity is elastic. Then next comes the consumer income. So if the consumer's income, that is the proportion of consumer's income that is spent, if the proportion of consumer's income that is spent is more, then that is elastic demand. Take the case of AC, take the case of laptop, take the case of mobile phone. Here the demand is more elastic. If the proportion of income spent is less, like you spend a very less amount in salt, or in of your rice. So there the demand is elastic for this AC and all these things, mobile phones, and the other one is the, it is inelastic. Next is possibility of postponement. If you can postpone the consumption of a commodity, then the demand for the commodity is elastic. If you cannot postpone it, then the demand for the commodity is inelastic. So what I told in case of price elasticity of demand is that, so elasticity of demand, as I said, is the responsiveness of demand to a change in price. So this responsiveness of change in demand, we can measure different ways. One is known as also, at times it is also known as ratio method. That is percentage change in quantity demanded, percentage change in price. Then another is point method, that is also known as geometric method. And third one that we come across is your revenue, total outlay method or total revenue method, which is total revenue, average revenue, marginal revenue, like this. So this price elasticity of demand depends on certain factors, which I have told you: nature of commodity, availability of substitute, number of uses of the commodity, consumer's income, proportion of income spent, and postponement of consumption. So this is your price elasticity of demand. So there is a relationship between marginal revenue and price elasticity of demand, which I have shown you, that marginal revenue is equal to price within this parenthesis 1 plus 1 by elasticity of demand. So next I come to your income elasticity of demand. So it is wrongly written something. So I'm explaining you the income elasticity of demand. So change, percentage change in quantity demanded divided by percentage change in income of the consumer. Percentage change in quantity demanded by percentage change in income. So this income elasticity of demand, which is written E1 as percentage delta Q change by percentage delta I, that is income. This income elasticity of demand can be greater than one, or income inelastic or unitary elastic. So if the income elasticity of demand, it is written as either EI or EY. If it is greater than one, good is income elastic. If it is less than one, good is income inelastic. And to the equal to one, good is unitary elastic. So this income elasticity of demand set, if the your income elasticity of demand is greater than one, then this is your normal good. If it is less than one, greater than zero, this is income elasticity, I'm telling you. Greater than one, good is normal good. Less than one, good is inferior good. Equal to one, good is independent good. So next I go to cross price elasticity of demand. So what is that? So here there are two commodities. Commodity B and commodity A. So it implies that change in quantity demanded of commodity B, change in price of commodity A, that is percentage change in quantity demanded of commodity B divided by percentage change in quantity divided of percentage change in price of commodity A. So this is the change, and this is the total, this is the change in price. If we find out this, we will find out the cross price elasticity of demand. If the cross, if it is greater than zero, we call this as goods are substitute. If it is less than zero, we said goods are complements. If it is equal to zero, we call this goods are independent goods. So this cross price elasticity demand, all these things what I have told you. So one thing I have not told you is your point elasticity of demand. So point elasticity of demand, if you have a graph paper or the diagram, if you touch the demand curve, touch the price axis and quantity axis, if I call this demand curve as AB curve, both the axes are met, AB curve, the middle point of the curve is, I call it as K. So point elasticity or geometric elasticity of demand is equal to lower segment of the curve divided by upper segment of the curve. When AB curve, the midpoint is K, then the elasticity of demand is equal to 1. If we move from K to A, the elasticity increases, and at point A, this becomes infinity. If we move downwards from K to B, the elasticity decreases, and at point B, the elasticity becomes 0. So at the AB demand curve, we can show that the demand curve at different points on the AB demand curve, starting from 0, less than 1, to equal to 1, then greater than 1, to equal to infinity. So this elasticity of demand ranging from 0 to infinity, price elasticity, your income elasticity, and your cross elasticity of demand. So from here we'll go to the chapter 3. That is demand estimation and forecasting. Demand estimation and forecasting. So in managerial economics, one of the important issues is demand forecasting. So how to forecast the demand? So there is a difference between demand estimation and demand forecasting. Suppose a relationship is given that quantity demanded is a function of price with a clear cut that A plus BP, A minus BP, that is P the price, A the intercept term, and this is a linear function. If you know that what is a linear function, a straight line function is a linear function. If we want to estimate from this particular your figure, the particular function with different price level, we want to estimate what will be the demand at different price level. But forecasting is different. Forecasting means the market leaders or the market manager, he will forecast whether the demand for the product will increase or decrease. This estimation is possible with the help of regression statistics. So what is this regression statistics? If I write y is equal to a plus bx, so this is a functional relationship which is a linear function between x and y. A linear function is one when your dependent variable is power is one, or it is not multiplied or divided by any other variable. So from this linear relationship, we have to estimate A and B given the value of X and Y. The value of X and the value of Y is given. From this, we'll estimate with simultaneous equation system, normal equation, we'll find the estimate value of A, that is A cap. We call this as estimate value. And B cap, we call it the estimate value of B. So at different price level of we find out a estimate your of demand, that is why I kept taking the relationship between x and y. So this relationship we will take into consideration, and we will predict, suppose I call it as quantity demanded of the particular commodity x, and this relationship that I want to find out with price level. So at different price level we will find estimate the value of x, and with the particular prediction of price level, what will be the quantity demanded. This what we call it as prediction or the forecasting of this, the demand forecasting. This demand forecasting can also be made with the help of time series data. A time series data is data in a period of time. So it has four components. The components are mainly trend, or we call it a secular trend, seasonal variation, cyclical variation, and irregular variation. So this time series analysis is the most important demand forecasting techniques, that is trend, seasonal variation, which is written as seasonality in your books, and cyclical variation, and random fluctuation, which we call it the irregular fluctuation. So I will explain what is these terms in. Let us start with the last one, that is random fluctuation or irregular fluctuation. So this occurs very irregularly. Take the case of now the COVID, the pandemic which is said, or the epidemic which we said, this is not a regular phenomenon. This is an irregular phenomenon. So depending this, we can also predict, which you come to later on. Then cyclical pattern. So what is the cyclical pattern? In economics, we have got a trade cycle. So in the trade cycle, there is inflationary situation, there is deflationary situation, there is recessionary situations like this. During the time of recession, there is lack of demand. As we said, because of this COVID-19, there is recession in Indian economy. The demand has come down. So the recession in the worst form, we call it as depression. So the world come across the ugliest depression in 1929. And people say that, economists say that this recession time, which is because of the COVID-19 is prevailing, this may be another recession of a very high type. So this, there is inflationary situation when there is more demand for goods and services. So that is, we call it as boom. So this boom analysis is also important in case of your forecasting, whether we will produce more or not. So that is seasonal variation. So what is the seasonal variation? See, season to season, this changes. So that you say that we feel three seasons, even if there is six seasons, we feel three seasons, like rainy season, winter season, and rainy season, summer season. So different time period, the product of different commodities or goods and services increases. So when there is very hot, the demand for AC, cooler, refrigerator, all cooling machineries demand increases. So like in case of winter times, there is demand for your room heater, all these things that are happening also available there. So like this in case of rainy season also there, you demand a particular goods and services, all these things are there. So seasonal variation is there. So the first thing is the trend. Trend is the, what is the trend of predicting a demand for a particular cloth? Suppose the particular company wants that he increased, want to increase the production of a particular cloth. So he has to look into the model. So this model may be a linear model which is given. And this linear model will be done through this statistical core fitting, which will predict what will be the demand in a particular time at the sweep heading. So besides this trend, which is available through your regression analysis, there is also 3 years moving average methods, 5 years moving average method like this. These are also help in forecasting demand depending on the situation concerned. As I have told you, in the irregular fluctuation, which I said, that is the present situation that are we are facing is a irregular situation. That is COVID-19 pandemic. So here the demand forecasting is difficult to predict because we demand, so the demand for mask. So demand for mask increases because of this irregular fluctuation or the irregular behavior of the disease. So like this, the social distancing is also there, all these things. So what product will increase? So that you say that demand for chloroquine in world increases because of this. So the world demand different chloroquine for treatment of this. So the PPE, the personal protective equipment demand also increases, all these things. So this depends on demand forecasting of the situation that prevails. So in case of seasonality, as I have told you, that then seasonality, we depend on different products, depending on the season, what will be demand for that. So besides, there is exponential exercise, which also helps in forecasting this equation. But the most important thing with demand forecasting is your regression model, which is generally applied. Either it is a single value regression model, or this regression model will be multiple regression model with different single value, single variable, multiple regression model. There are multiple variables are there. So estimation is one thing. We estimate it through a particular demand function, but forecasting, we predict it with the help of regression models or different fluctuations. All these things are there. So this is what is our demand analysis. So demand is the most important part of any managerial economics. So we here say that it is individual demand and market demand, we say, and there is aggregate demand which comes to your macroeconomics level. So depending on the demand, the manager concerned decides what to do, what not to do. So the elasticity of demand helps in increasing the quantity demanded, either depending on the of the demand, either it is elastic or inelastic. If it is elastic, you have to decide whether the price had to increase and decrease to increase the total revenue of the company concerned. And like this, the income elasticity demand give an indication what to do when the demand elasticity of demand is more than one or less than one. All these things they indicate. So demand law is the first stepping stone towards the other analysis, but depending on the demand, other analysis starts. So without demand, there cannot be anything possible in the market, because if there is no demand, there is no meaning of producing a commodity, which will come to later on. So demand is the pivot economic problem that comes to the managerial economics or to managers. If the demand is there, then the product will be produced. So all these, whatever I have said, that is your elasticity of demand or the forecasting estimation demand, it helps in increasing or decreasing the demand in the market concerns or the increase in aggregate demand. So ये भाई ये करियो क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन करियो ना कौन ना आउट इट हेलो हेलो
यस सर
एबे क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन करियो ना आउ कोन को पचारियो पिला
नाही सर किसी क्वेश्चन अछि मो पाखरे
अच्छा
आज्ञा सर जणे एक्चुअली पचारि छथि व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन इलास्टिसिटी एंड इन इलास्टिसिटी ऑफ डिमांड सर
तो इलास्टिसिटी ऑफ डिमांड एज आई हैव टोल्ड यू इज द फार्मूला दैट इज चेंज इन डिपेंडेंट वेरिएबल डिवाइडेड बाय चेंज इन इंडिपेंडेंट वेरिएबल इन आवर केस दिस इज चेंज इन क्वांटिटी डिमांडेड डिवाइडेड बाय चेंज इन प्राइस because we refer to the price elasticity of demand. So demand may be elastic or demand may be inelastic. So elastic demand implies we measure the elasticity of demand with that formula. If it is greater than one, it is a pure number independent of unit. If it is greater than one, if the change in quantity demanded by the change in price is greater than one, we call it as elastic demand. Elastic demand implies if the price of the commodity falls, you demand more than proportionality of the commodity. But in case of inelastic demand, if your demand is less than one, we call it as inelastic demand. Suppose price of salt falls. When the price of salt falls, you do not demand a huge amount of salt. Your demand for the salt is what it is. It cannot be increased. So you spend less on them even if the price falls. But here the price falls, you spend more on them. For example, refrigerator or AC, I told you. Here the demand is elastic demand. If the price of refrigerator falls, then demand for refrigerator will increase more than proportionately. One of pasta outla that will be increased by 10. In the salt case, the price of fall kariola, salt from 5 kg agar 50 kg kini on. It has the difference in elasticity.
Thank you, sir. And there is another question. That what is the difference between inferior goods and normal goods?
So inferior goods. So take the case of rice and bajra. So these are millets which you say. Rice is a normal good, but bajra is a inferior good because the price of rice increases, we cannot afford to afford it because of the income decrease. We go for an inferior good. So in case of inferior good, the law of demand does not operate there. The inferior goods, the law of demand is upward sloping. Price increases, demand increases. Price falls, demand falls. So as I've given the example that you now want to, because your income increases, you want to substitute millets, your rice with millets. You do not go for millets, you go for rice. But if the price of rice increases to a huge amount, if you are not able to afford rice, then you go for the inferior good, that is your millets, even if the price of the goods increases. Hello. It's a special kind of goods where law of demand does not operate.
Yes, sir. Sir, there is another question. What is the effect of advertising in demand?
So as you know, from 1991 onwards, we have an economy which is, we call it as globalized economy. In economics language, we call it as LPG, liberalization, privatization, and globalization, LPG. So globalization means we open up our economy to foreign companies. That is multinational corporation. So we have many multinational corporations. I give you example. For example, your Hyundai is a multinational corporation. your food, the multinational, whatever product now you see in the market, either in the fashion circle or in the essential goods services, you see that many multinational companies are operating. So previously, there are multinational companies, but there are few. For example, take the case of cold drinks. Your Pepsi is there, your Coca-Cola is there. How could I could achieve? So there's a competition between Pepsi and Coca-Cola. So they want to sell their product. If they want to sell their product, that is, they want to sell their product means the demand for the product should increase. So the demand for the, how can the demand for the product will increase? Suppose you are a cricket player and you are fond of cricketer, then you are fond of the present captain of India, that is Virat Kohli. So if you advertise for the good, then you will go for that. So because you are a fan of Virat Kohli and you are fond of cricket, you go for that because Virat Kohli is the brand ambassador of the product. So that is why advertisement increases the demand for the product. So this, like this, anything you can, suppose you are a fan of Amitabh Bachchan. So when Amitabh Bachchan advertise a thing, you go for that. So your demand will increase for that particular product. So that is why advertisement increases the demand for the product because of the advertisement by the brand ambassador for which you are fond of, or because you are concerned with televisions, all these things, so looking at the television, then television advertisement, we can say catchy for you, you go for the product, even if you do not like for the product. That is why advertisement increases the demand for the product. If there is no advertisement, then people do not know, even if there is, the product is good. For example, take the case of your turmeric of Kandhamal. So this is a good product, but there is lack of advertisement for that. Or there is advertisement for your Bharat turmeric, your Ruchi turmeric, all these things are there, or Tata turmeric. So if the advertisement increases it, if there is no advertisement, you are not able to go for that product. So advertisement is a role in increasing the demand for the product.
Thank you, sir. Another question is there. What is barometric forecasting? Sir, what is barometric forecasting?
Barometric forecasting.
Yes, sir.
Barometric forecasting is based on the observed relationship between different economic indicators. So what are those economic indicators? So economic indicators are like this. One economic indicator is your income. Another economic indicator is your price. There are also leading indicators. There are also not leading indicators like this. So these indicators which are between different economic indicators, if the economic indicators present, suppose there is a product which you like because it is up to the satisfaction of the consumer, because consumer satisfaction is another factor which is also part of the consumer. So the consumer is satisfied with this, that is, taste and preferences are for this particular product, then we call this as barometric indicator. This leads to increase in demand for related products. If we go for, let us say that we are wearing a particular shirt, the branded shirt we are wearing. So this, the taste and preferences for this branded shirt comes down. Then we will go for other branded shirt. This going for other branded SAT, we call it as barometric forecasting.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I think all the questions we have covered, and now we came to the end of this session, and I hope the learners must have enjoyed and also learned a lot from this session. So on behalf of Odisha State Open University, I truly appreciate Vinod sir's valuable time spent for guiding us. And in this present class, we have studied about law of demand, what is a demand schedule, what is a demand curve, the concept of elasticity of demand, forecasting and estimation of demand. So again, thank you, sir. And I also thanks to the learner of Odisha State Open University for hearing the lecture so patiently. And I would like to also thank to our technical team, Rudra sir and Devasis sir. And also I'd like to thank Prithviraj sir for supporting. And for in this, we come to the end of the session. And thank you all. Thank you, the learners. And I would like to request all the learners to be get themselves disconnected from this session. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much.